Welcome to the Faith Lutheran Church Bible Study, The Triumph of the Lamb, a study in Revelation. Tonight in our Wednesday class, we discuss judgment before the great white throne from Revelation chapter 20, verses 11 through 15. Let's listen in.
Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for this time together to study your word, and we thank you for this trek through the book of Revelation. We pray tonight, Lord, that as we continue our study, that you would send us your blessings and you would guide our conversation so that we are strengthened in our faith and in our understanding of your word. We thank you tonight, Lord, that you hear our prayers and you answer them according to your will. We pray for Joey as she continues to mourn the loss of Jim. We ask you, Father, to give her peace and the promise of the resurrection, and hold her tightly now and give her strength. We pray for Tom as he prepares to go in for a rather daunting chemo session. Lord, we pray that you would have mercy on him and you would give him strength. Guide him through this process. Be with him in his body. We pray you would give him strength, but we also pray that you would give him strength in his spirit. Remind him of your presence through this time and give him your healing. Prepare his body well for the surgery that is to come. We pray for Lorraine as she continues to heal from her fall. Strengthen her and her body and help her to return soon. We pray for Abner that his legs would heal and you would give him strength. And we pray for Katie that you would keep her safe and watch over her in the Middle East. Bless her time there. Strengthen her in the work that she does and guide her to conversations where she's able to further your gospel's message into the lives of people. Have mercy on her. For Jesus' sake, we pray. Amen. Where do we get in this class? I don't even know anymore.
Verse 5 of 21.
You're wrong. You are. So we've talked about, we got through chapter 20 in this class?
And the first step to verse 11.
Verse 11. I think you're confusing this with Sunday morning.
Sunday morning we got through verse 8.
So chapter 20, verse, what did you say?
11.
Okay, that's where we got this morning too. Okay, right. We almost got through verse 11 this morning, so this will be interesting to see. We did get through verse 11. It took us an hour and a half. And then we did the rest of the chapter in 10 minutes. Because we are going to finish chapter 20 at least tonight. Tell me where we've been, what we've been discussing, what's been going on in the last three chapters to bring me up to speed to where we are right now. Because I would like to eat my dessert. So, what do you got? What has been the overarching theme of the last three chapters? The beast, yes.
And then defeat of Satan last week.
Yep. And what else? Who else was defeated? Not just the beast.
And the harlot.
Mm-hmm. Correct. And why is this good news for the church?
Because then they at least cannot come against the person and persecute the church any longer.
Correct. So they're gone for good. The church is free from them forever. That's very good. Yes. Now, what else has happened in that time that we've seen? There have been some happy things, too.
Well, we had the wedding of the Lamb?
Yeah, the marriage feast of the Lamb. Very good. So the time of the church, where she is awaiting the coming of her bridegroom, is now come to an end, or at least it had come to an end there in chapter 19, as the bridegroom arrives and they have the marriage feast of the Lamb in the new heavens and the new earth. This is a resurrection picture, and we're going to get more into more resurrection pictures here throughout the text from here on out. But that is a picture of the last of all things. Then we saw the rider on the white horse who also comes to judge, and this again is a picture of the end of all things, where the rider on the white horse comes and he judges not only the beast and the harlot, I think, but also those who have followed the beast and the harlot. at the end of his judgment. Then we had the millennium. Talk to me about the millennium. This is very good, Joyce, by the way. This is very good.
You've had it before.
I know. And I liked it then, too. What is the millennium? What does it represent? Yes, the millennium means the 1,000-year reign of Christ, but what does it represent? When is it?
Right now.
Now. We are living in the millennium right now. So then what do we mean when we say that Satan is bound? Sort of. To what he can't do his evil deeds to what end?
He cannot destroy the church.
He cannot overcome the church. This is the binding of the strong man so that he's unable to stop the work of God through his church. And so this is what we've said when it says that the devil is bound for 1,000 years. It does not mean he's inactive. It simply means he's not overcoming the church. The same thing we saw in chapter 12 when the dragon tried to devour the beast. Don't get those confused. Tried to devour the woman who represents Mary in the church. He was incapable of doing it because all of his attacks were swallowed up by the earth, something like this. So he's bound from overcoming the work of the church. Does that last forever? Let me ask it this way. Is he bound forever?
No.
Towards the end of the millennium, he's given what we call Satan's little season. And he's set free to deceive the nations and to persecute the nations. And how widespread is that deception?
Four corners
of the earth, so worldwide. And it's probably worth saying on some level here that the deception and the work of the devil now, maybe I'm reading too much or going too far with this statement, but there are places where it seems as if the devil's doing more than in other places. So right now in the southern hemisphere, the church is spreading like crazy, whereas before it was not. And it was in the western, northern hemisphere where the Christianity really thrived. Now that has changed significantly. And so the church looks to be thriving in places and dying in others. To our eyes, whatever that means. But Luther will talk this way in the catechisms. It's very interesting where he says, God has given us his gospel now. He's given us his commandments, and we will foolishly in Germany and recklessly be breaking those commandments, and he may cease to do his work here. He may move on to somewhere else. Those are words of warning, I think. And so what this is suggesting is that the localized strength of the church in one place kind of the waxing and the waning of the church is not there, that the church is just attacked on all corners. It's just suffering everywhere you look. Now, does that mean the devil overcomes the church in those moments? No, but it does mean the persecution and the deception grows stronger and worse beyond anything we've experienced yet. Or we're experiencing now and it's just so subtle we don't realize it. Okay? So far, so good? Yes?
You say that when the devil is bound, he cannot work to overthrow the church.
Yes.
But it doesn't mean he isn't working.
Mm-hmm.
I thought that was his sole purpose in working.
Yeah, but it's in vain.
But he's still trying to overthrow.
Yeah.
It's just he's not going to be successful.
Correct. Okay. Yeah. Gates of hell will not prevail against the church is the language Jesus uses, yes. And I think The illustration I think that's making a lot of sense in my head is that he is like a mafia boss in jail, right?
Pretty active in jail.
Exactly. Exactly right.
Yeah.
But he's bound.
Yeah.
But he's in jail and having to do work from behind bars. And we saw that earlier where he's using the beast and the harlot to sort of as his patsies or something like this. I don't know. His hitmen. Yes, correct. Yeah. While bound, yet he's still very busy, very active. Someone, and another description I've heard of his binding this way, I think is also a helpful illustration. He's like a bear caught in a trap, where he's not running roughshod all over the place. He's not in Dave's house, he's not in your cabin or anything. But you still don't want to get close to him. You don't want to go up and pet him, right? He's things aren't good. So that's kind of the idea you have there. All right. So far, so good? All right. So then we saw the defeat of Satan in a very short verse, or in one verse, and then we just kind of moved on from it. So the devil after the millennium and the little season is bound. Is judged. And where is his judgment? Where is he judged to?
The lake.
The lake of fire. Who else is there?
Beast and the harlot.
Yes, the beast and the harlot. So he's judged along with them in the same way. It is worth noting, I was looking at this in my readings, my devotion readings, that the Exodus, I'm going through Exodus right now, and there were the unclean parts of when they would offer up the sacrifice to God. They would take the unclean parts of the animal, the gross parts, the refuse and all that, and they would pile it up and they would throw it outside the camp into the fire. It was the place where the unusable stuff was, the stuff that was impure. And so that it wouldn't corrupt anything, it was taken out and thrown in the fire and burnt up out there. That's kind of the same idea. I think this lake of fire imagery is probably drawn on some level from that. Also, we said this before, Gehenna. Gehenna was the place, again, probably similar kind of place, outside of Jerusalem where they took the trash and it just burnt forever. It was always burning to burn up the trash and the impure things and all that kind of stuff. So anything that would be corrupting of the city. So there you go. All right. So that, and by the way, that is our imagery of hell. That's the imagery the Bible uses for hell. That's not to say that hell will be an eternal fire, so to speak, though the imagery always tends to move that way, that it is a place where God puts you and it's suffering forever apart, well, not really apart from him, but apart from his gracious presence, something like that.
Is Jesus in hell?
What do you mean by that?
Well, we say that in the Creed.
Well, he descended into hell and descended.
Yeah.
So no.
He didn't stay there.
Yeah, he's not. He's not. Yeah,
he
rose from the dead.
No, but he did go there.
Mm-hmm. But he's not there now. In that way, there was a verse we read earlier, somewhere in the book of Revelation, which I forget where now, where those who are damned are suffering in the presence of Christ. And that's a disturbing one for us because we think of hell as like separation from God, but it's separation from God's mercy. That Christ is their judge, and they do stand condemned beneath his law for eternity. And don't get mad at it. It's what the Bible says, and that Jesus is the one judging them, and he's righteous in doing it. So they stand beneath his judgment. And so hell is not so much separation from God as it is separation from the grace of God. There you get God only in his wrath. Might be a way of thinking about it. Which actually makes hell worse. You cannot look upon God and rejoice. You cannot look upon God and hope. That part of the Bible where it says he causes his rain to fall on the righteous and the unrighteous, not anymore. Just on the righteous. So, something like that. So is he in hell? Not in the century, not in the creedal sense, but as the judge. He's overseeing the judgment, something like that. Yeah. Okay. Well, let's go to something happier than that. Oh, no, we don't get to. Can someone read 11 through 15 for us, please?
Sure.
Thanks.
Then I saw a great white throne, and him who was seated on it, earth and sky, fled from his presence, and there was no place for them. And I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne, and books were opened. Another book was opened, which is the book of life. The dead were judged according to what they had done, as recorded in the books. The sea gave up the dead that were in it, and death and Hades gave up the dead that were in them. And each person was judged according to what he had done. Then death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire. The lake of fire is the second death. If anyone's name was not found written in the book of life, he was thrown into the lake of fire.
Okay. So, now we are here at the final judgment on the human race. This is the last judgment. We will hear in the next section in chapter 21 comments of judgment, and we will have other discussion of judgment throughout the text. But here we come to the final imagery of the judgment, God's final word on those who did not believe. And this is called, in many circles, the Great White Throne Judgment, because God is seated on a great white throne. Now, it is God, but specifically among the triune Godhead, which member of the Trinity might we say this is? That is the right reasoning, but the wrong answer. Because earlier in the text, in chapter 4, we see the Father seated on the throne, and the same language is now used here. Chapter 4, I saw the Lord seated on the throne, and he is dominant and central, and he's surrounded by the hosts of heaven. Here, it looks as if it's probably the Father once again now carrying out the judgment. Now, that becomes a little tricky because throughout the rest of the New Testament, it said that in other places, Jesus is the one given to judge. But remember also what Jesus says in John's Gospel, I only judge the way the Father tells me to. I see it as, I call it as he sees it, might be a way of saying it. So that drawing too harsh of a distinction between who carries out the last judgment is unnecessary. Is the Father involved with it? Yeah. Is the Son involved with it? Yes. Is the Holy Spirit involved with it? Yes, because it's not like the two of them are doing some work and the Holy Spirit's off, you know, having a water break or something like this. But they're all working together. But here we just have the Father as the one who is imaged for us, I believe, because it's the same language we have in chapter 4. Okay? All right. And from his presence, earth and sky fled away. Now, this is a very interesting passage, I think, that contains a lot of other biblical theology. We get this imagery a lot throughout the New Testament, where the creation is seen fleeing or being undone or something like this at the coming of God, right? So, for example, first, Adam and Eve, they flee from God in the garden. Remember this, they run and they hide. So that might be kind of some of the imagery here. In 16 verse 20 in Revelation, it talks about the islands disappearing and the mountains going away. And I think some of the meaning there is, there's nowhere to run to. Baby, nowhere to hide. Now, who sang that? It wasn't the Beatles, Tom. Come on now. Nowhere to run to, baby, nowhere to hide.
Oh, goodness, what? No.
No. Born to Run, that's very different. Tommy James and the Shondells. Good effort, everybody. Good effort. Tommy James and the Shondells. Okay, so that's probably not even right now that I say it. I'm pretty sure someone... Okay, anyways, moving on. So there's nowhere to run, nowhere to hide. The islands are gone. You cannot sail for escape like Jonah kind of tries to do. You cannot hide in the mountains. Remember, Jesus says, woe to you in those days. The wicked will be crawling out for the mountains to fall on them so they have a place to hide from the judgment of God. It's all gone. There is no place to hide. It's simply the imagery here is God and the sinner, or God and the sinful, God and humanity. There's nothing else there. There's no angels. There's just God. To judge.
Present earth and heaven.
Present earth and heaven?
The NASB.
It says present earth?
Yeah.
That's curious.
Yeah.
I do like...
I saw a great white throne and him who sat upon it from whose presence... Oh, presence.
Okay.
From whose presence earth and heaven fled away.
Yeah.
And no place was found for it.
Yeah, and I would say that that's probably pretty good. But just understand that now... When we talk of the heavens and the earth in the Bible, that means the sky and the land. It does not mean the heavenly abode of God. The heavens and the earth are typically referring to sky and sea and land and all that kind of stuff. He created the heavens. Exactly right. So the stars and the moon and all of that kind of stuff. And clouds. But I like that language better. I think it's a better translation that the heavens and the earth... and there's nowhere for them to go. The other thing to keep in mind is this. If someone could do this quickly for me, go to 2 Peter 3:10 through 13. If I could get someone to go to Psalm 102, verses 25 and 26. Thank you. Isaiah 51, verse 6. And Mark 13:31. Anyone got the Isaiah text?
I'm getting close.
Jeff, okay. Joyce, you have that? Jeff, can you do the Mark 13:31?
Sure.
Okay.
51:6.
Okay. Okay, so the other thing to keep in mind is on the last day of the judgment, this might be very, though it is probably somewhat symbolic, and some have argued that all that's meant here is sort of a poetic way of saying all of the humanity is running away from him. Everyone's just fleeing from the judgment of God, something like this. But if we read this one just a little bit more literally, it lines up with a lot of what we see throughout the New Testament, that the last judgment, here's what's going to happen to the creation. So who's got 2 Peter? Who's got that one for me?
I've got
Dave,
it.
Go for it. Thank you.
Okay. This is 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 10. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief. The heavens will disappear with a roar. The elements will be destroyed by fire. And the earth and everything in it will be laid bare. Since everything will be destroyed in this way, what kind of people ought you to be? You ought to live holy and godly lives as you look forward to the day of the Lord and speed its coming. That day will bring about the destruction of the heavens by fire and the elements will melt in the heat. But in keeping with this promise, we are looking forward to a new heaven and a new earth, the home of righteousness.
Okay, so what is happening to the heavens and the earth on the last day according to 2 Peter? Burning up. Burning up. All right, Psalm 102, 26. Who's got that one? Keith, 25 and 26, please.
Of old you laid the foundation of the earth, and the heavens are the work of your hands. They will perish, but you will remain. They will all wear out like a garment. You will change them like a robe, and they will pass away.
The more I hear that verse, the more I think it is just wonderful. You will change them like a robe. Like you're going to be putting something new on. I think that's just terrific. Okay, Isaiah 51:6.
Lift up your eyes to the heavens. Look at the earth beneath. The heavens will vanish like smoke.
There it is.
The earth will wear out like a garment, and its inhabitants die like flies. But my salvation will last forever. My righteousness will never fail.
There's just the sneaking suspicion that John may have read that text somewhere. I mean, that is just exactly this. See, here's the nice thing about the evening classes. You guys don't talk as much, so we can actually read the verses. In the morning class, they're just so chatty.
Other things.
Yeah, that's right. Hopefully they watch this and learn. Mark. I won't. I will. Yeah. Marjorie and Kevin aren't here tonight either. So, yeah. Mark 13:31.
Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away.
Good heavens. Now these verses are just popping out of me. You know what's great about that? Heaven and earth will pass away, but whose words will not pass away? Does Isaiah ever say something like that? No, not unless he's speaking on behalf of God. And Jesus is saying, for those who like to say Jesus never claimed to be God, that one's getting rocks thrown at you, okay? I mean, that's a blasphemous verse if he's not God. So this is just interesting stuff, like what's happening to the creation at the end? It's all being undone because the whole thing has been corrupted in the fall. Is the creation bad? Is the creation itself evil? No, and in fact, I think Keith's verses were very critical in grabbing this because Psalm 102 says in verse 25, you made it. And in the end, it's going to be kind of destroyed. It's all going to perish. But the word of God remains. And that's a theme in 1 Peter as well. The word of the Lord remains forever. Jesus says, the heavens and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. And then I think it was Joyce's, the Isaiah 51:6, that says, the people will fall like flies, but my salvation, is that what it says?
My salvation will be like righteousness and will not
perish. And now that doesn't just mean like his platonic abstract righteousness somewhere up in the sky, but those for whom he has declared right. Yeah, so I mean, these are really quite something. And this is exactly the imagery I think that Revelation is working with right here.
Why does it say the heavens are the work of your hands? What do people or the devil have to do with changing or corrupting heaven?
So, all of creation is, heavens and earth, all of creation is plagued by the fall into sin. So remember when Adam and Eve fall, or rebel, which is probably better language. What is Adam's curse? Do you guys remember what Adam's curse is?
He's going to work the ground with thistles and thorns.
Yeah, that's right. The thorns and thistles will infest the ground. And the idea there is not just that, you know, it's going to be difficult to work now, but all of creation is groaning underneath the curse of sin. All of creation. The heavens and the earth. And by saying the heavens and the earth, it doesn't necessarily mean something like this. That star has a sin stain on it or something like this. But rather it's saying all of creation. Heavens and earth is a poetic way of saying everything is encompassed and everything is affected by this. Everything that is groans in Romans 8, groans in anticipation for the resurrection of the sons of God, waiting for the resurrection to be made right again.
Like the things that have died before this point, aren't they in heaven?
No, again, so heavens there doesn't mean heaven, like where God dwells. Heavens means sky. It doesn't mean anything more than... oh, goodness, who was the philosopher, Immanuel Kant, who wrongly said, I only know... something. The only truth I know is the starry skies above, or like the starry heavens above, and the truth in my heart, or something like this. But when he uses the word heavens, he's not talking about where God lives. He's talking about the sky or something like this. Yeah, that's right. That's where you want to go with that. Genesis, early on. Yeah, it's a bad quote of Kant. That's okay.
It's everything that God had created.
Yes, the creation is corrupted, impacted by sin. Because... and this is very interesting, because who had authority over the creation?
Man.
Yeah. So before we get too angry at the environmentalists who say, well, mankind is harming the creation. Probably. Actually, yeah. Only it's a lot deeper than just throwing, you know, your plastic bottle out the window. Did I tell you this? This is a great story. My neighbors, they're Muslim, and the wife is from, make sure I get this right, the wife is from Jordan, and the husband is from, I want to say Syria or something like this, but they're not actually supposed to be married, so they live in Moore Park, right? Because they're not supposed to be married, and they can't travel to each other's home as well. It's this confusion with it. But the kids went to Jordan this summer with their mom, and when they came back, I was listening to them talk to our kids because they all play out in the alley, and one of the girls goes, you know the best thing about Jordan? Is you can just throw your trash out the window and nobody cares. So if you ever travel to Jordan, there's one of the highlights, I guess.
In Egypt, everybody throws their trash on the top of their building. It's flat.
Uh-huh.
Just all kinds of trash.
Yeah, it's amazing. Yeah, there's just no...
Jerusalem's kind of the
same way. Yeah.
Same way. There'd be an empty lot and
it's full of trash
and it's burning.
Yeah. But the point here, I mean, this is really interesting because that is to say, not that, you know, but there is a moral responsibility that humanity has to the creation because God gave us authority over the creation. It's ours to tend to. Adam and Eve were to tend the garden. So we do have a responsibility to it. I mean, it's something worth thinking about. It's not a liberal move, Dave. I'm just telling you what the Bible says.
No, but the problem comes about in believing that we, by our own power, can correct it, because in most cases, I think the majority of people don't understand why the creation is corrupted. It's corrupted because of sin, not just because we threw a plastic bottle out.
No, correct. Those sins themselves also impact as well.
Yes.
Yeah. And I mean, the real impact we see, and I think like the environmental crisis, if that's even a thing, but for example... pollution in the air is bad for our lungs. Just is. So pollution in the air is bad for the lungs. I think we can agree on that. Yes, I'm not making a political statement here. Okay, very good. So pollution in the air is bad for the lungs. Here, the air is now working against the person. The air now works against us. And that is a helpful, at least it's a helpful illustration of the way that sin has corrupted the creation so that it works against us now. Thorns in the ground are not useful for picking fruit or picking carrots or something like this, because now you're pricking your finger. It works against you. The ground is pain. It's hard work to toil it. You're dependent on the elements to some extent, and you cannot force the rain to do what you want. Sometimes you have a drought, right? I mean, so you see these things going on where we can't control the weather, we can't harness it, we sort of have to trust in God to care for us through it, but the creation itself now works against us. And we see this imagery a lot, and we'll talk about this here in a second. The best place to see this imagery is with the sea, right? We just read about this weekend, and these numbers seem awfully large to me, but this is what the paper said, is 5,000 people along the coast here had to be rescued from tides that were pulling them out. 5,000 people? Because the ocean's kind of dangerous. I mean, unless you're a surfer and can control the thing, but even then, right, there's sharks. So it is a scary place. It's an intimidating place. It's not a safe place. It's somewhat chaotic, and it works against humanity. You cannot harness the power of the sea. The only person who ever could, and he did this as a human, right, was Jesus, when he walks on the water. So it's kind of an interesting...
Or tells it to be still.
Tells it to stop. Hey, storm, stop it, right? I mean, that's a very interesting thing. Luther, in his great Genesis lectures, has this line, and we have a fly problem at my house, so I tend to think he's right. But he says that gnats didn't exist until after the fall. That they weren't around until after the fall. Yeah, that's right. It's exactly right. Luther's great, though. In that thing, he says, humanity in creation could run faster than any cheetah, could see further than any owl at night. I mean, he says, like, they were like this superhuman thing, and now that might be a little misguided, but his point there is somewhat helpful, is to say, we've lost a lot because of sin. Death really has had a negative impact on the creations. All right. Now I'm the one taking us off track. Okay, very good. So, sky and sea, the heavens and the earth.
Tom will help you out.
Yeah, good. Oh, your hand's going up, yes.
Well, I never thought of it quite that way. I was, when I lived in Idaho, there's a place right outside of Yellowstone Park called Island Park, and it's really, really flat there. And every year, one, two, three people would freeze to death because they'd go out into the trees and they couldn't figure out where they were. Didn't take compass or anything. They thought, oh, I'm just going to go out here and I'll come back. And then they couldn't figure out where back was, and they kept going the wrong direction and they were freezing to death. To me, that was always just. And I can give you a thousand examples like that, because I used to love the wilderness. It was just the awesome power of nature versus the impotence of man. Whether that's, I guess I never really quite associated that with the fall, but I suppose you could, you know, say that, well, there was a time in which man really was as powerful as nature, or more powerful than nature. Yeah. We were told us to do it.
And we had authority over it. And now, because of sin, we fight it. It fights us. There's pushback. It's the same with the animals. Before the fall, and you get this with resurrection language, right? Like the lamb lies down with the lion, the child sticks his hand in the hole of the snake and does not get bit. That's resurrection talk right there. Right now, it doesn't work that way. Because the animals fear us. Or at least that's why they attack, or they're stronger and they're hungry, so they attack. But it's, there's not a peace. The Hebrew word is the shalom there. There's not cohesiveness or unity. Things are working against each other. So whether it's your example or the way Luther talks, things are in opposition to one another. The relationship is destroyed or broken, something like that. Yeah, yeah. I think that's a great illustration, though, that the elements are not friendly. Unless you live in Moore Park, yeah.
Not worse than not friendly. They're just far more powerful than we give them credit for.
Correct.
We think we can just go out and do anything we want, put a child on a bison head,
yeah,
and take a picture of it. You know.
Oh no! Someone did that.
Oh yeah.
Oh heavens!
And then they wonder why somebody gets hurt.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. But nature is far more powerful in that regard than we are at mm-hmm. this point.
Mm-hmm. Correct.
We used to have respect for it. Now we have too much pride that we know better. We don't have to take precautions. We know better.
Right.
Well, that's pride.
Yeah, it's the difference between tending to the creation and using it for our own ends, right? So it's the difference between having authority over something and using something for my own selfish gain, something mm-hmm. like that. I think it's great, yeah.
I think biblically, the final straw in the creation was just after Noah came off the boat. And,
uh-huh.
and God makes a statement to Noah. This is in Genesis chapter 9, verse 2. The fear and dread of you will fall upon all the beasts of the earth and all the birds of the air, upon every creature that moves along the ground, and upon all the fish of the sea. They are given into your hands. And you know, you walk outside, and I've got bird feeders all over the place in front of my house. And what's the first thing that happens? You walk outside, they're gone. And you know, if you sit there for a while, they will come back, but you have to be very still. They're yeah. afraid of us.
Yeah.
So that's the damage that's been done to them.
They're not that way on the Galapagos.
Yeah. Well, they just they haven't figured out man yet.
They have enough tourists.
Well, that's sort of true. I mean, like in is it Venice? Is that what I'm thinking of? Where that is it Versailles? Where's that place you go in Europe and you walk in that big courtyard and the pigeons just flock all over you. Where is that?
There were lots of places in London that did that.
Yeah, wherever it is. But I mean, you see this in certain places where the fear has been, it's not there for whatever reason. Yeah. But they're, man has tamed the animals. My dog is afraid of other dogs, apparently, because she fights them all the time. I don't know. But whatever it is, generally speaking, the relationship is broken. If I were to go to the Galapagos Islands, I would be the one who's terrified. Because the birds are just awful things. Okay. And there's no place found. The creation is undone. It's judged. It's going to be started over. We're going to get a new heavens and a new earth. Things are going to be renewed. And again, we've talked about this before, but the question did come up this morning. The goal here when we die, this is not doing this. It's not saying on the last day God's going to burn everything up and there'll be no more createdness and everything will just be spirit and we'll all float in heaven like angels. He's making things new. He's resurrecting. Remember, the big theme is not death, then go to heaven, but dying and rising. That is the hope of the Christian. And the resurrection is unto a new heavens and a new earth. It's not a spiritual, let's say it this way, it's not a disembodied existence. It's a spiritual existence, but not in the way we tend to think. We tend to think of spirits as ghosts, right? 1 Corinthians 15 is going to talk about us having a spiritual body. That doesn't mean our bodies are going to be ghost-like bodies. It means that they are going to be Holy Spirited bodies, but bodies nonetheless. Resurrected, real-life things, just like Jesus when he rose from the dead.
New bodies?
New, renewed is the way we want to say it.
But not new bodies. Same old body.
That's, here we go again.
Yeah, I've been counting on a new body.
Me too.
Yeah, so I mean, this gets a little tricky with the language here. Because Paul in 1 Corinthians 15 is going to say it's something like this. What is sown perishable is raised imperishable. What is sown in shame is raised in glory. Something like this. And the imagery he uses is of a seed. When you plant a seed in the ground, it dies, he says. And then what happens? It grows. So the seed that is planted is the same thing as the plant that comes out.
It just doesn't die.
Well, you're using science that you know. Paul's using what he had in the first century. So that's, you know, okay. Paul did as much work as he could. I don't know.
But the fact that he doesn't know doesn't change reality.
Correct, sure. But the imagery is you take a seed, you bury it in the ground.
And then
just like you do to a body that's dead. And then that seed will grow forth from the ground as something far greater and more glorious. And that's the imagery Paul is using. He says you put the body in the ground and it dies, but when Christ... hopefully you reverse the order there. when Christ returns, he calls you forth from the grave. You rise again, but as something entirely new. Where this gets tricky is in 2 Corinthians, it talks as if he has a body waiting for you up in heaven. So that's almost like a new thing. And you're like, well, so which is it? Well, it's a heavenly renewed body. So I think the best way for my mind to grasp it, and this is my current understanding, and if someone has a better theology, I'll be glad to take it. But the best way to look at it is not merely the illustrations Paul uses. Those are obviously very helpful because they're inspired by God. But the picture of Christ himself, where Paul says, if you die in a death with him like his, you will be raised in a resurrection like his. 1 Corinthians 6. And the idea there is when Christ rose from the dead, was it still Jesus? Yes. Was it his same body?
Yeah, because he showed the...
Yes,
the holes in his
absolutely. Correct. So it's the same body. But what happens when he's on the road to Emmaus?
They have a hard time recognizing.
No one knows who he is. Yeah. This is like one of the greatest... funny, like we don't laugh enough at the Bible. It's the funniest scenes in the whole Bible when he's walking on the road to Emmaus and he sees these two guys and he says, this is Easter, you know, Easter. Why are you guys so depressed? Oh, haven't you heard the news? What news? Of Jesus of Nazareth. He's standing right next to you. Like, what do you mean, have you heard the news? Oh, we thought he was a great prophet, but then he died. And Jesus is like, oh, no kidding. How about this? This is a curious story. You idiots. And then he kind of goes into explaining to them, what is that on the floor? Is that a cockroach? Sorry, I'm easily distracted. Oh, that's a bee?
Oh,
we're good then. Just maybe tire. Okay, we'll watch that thing. He heard that gnats came after the fall and he was curious about himself. But the idea there is Jesus is not immediately recognized. Something's changed. Something's different. He's renewed. He's resurrected. I mean, this is not a singular instance. It happens also with Mary. Mary, who's somewhat familiar with Jesus. And she sees him and says, she thinks he's the gardener. What have you done with my Lord? I'm right here. And she walks to them and she talks to them and he tells her she's his own and all this kind of stuff, right? There you are, Cecily. Oh man, we totally went after Francis Chan last week. You weren't even here. Oh good, okay, very good. I'm glad to hear it.
You will forever be known as Cecily's friend.
Good, well, Cecily's good. Friend. Someone needs to show him grace. Go ahead.
It also says that after the resurrection, there will be no more weeping, no more pain, mm-hmm. no more mourning. That's because we've been renewed.
Mm-hmm.
And whatever we are, we'll be happy with.
Yes, that's right. The body that rises from the dead will not feel the corruption of sin. It just won't know it. And the wages of sin is death. And everything that comes with it, that includes is poor grammar. It includes, we'll all have just great diction in heaven. What will we speak?
German.
German? Who knows if it's going to be German? That's a great discussion. I think it's Hebrew. It's probably Hebrew. Yeah, go ahead.
If we will be resurrected like Christ,
mm-hmm.
and Christ was transfigured, could the body then mentioned in 2 Corinthians, the heavenly body, be that then we undergo some transfiguration then?
Transfiguration, perhaps, and... No, follow me on this, because I don't want to say that Moses or Elijah is resurrected at that point. However, Moses and Elijah reflect the glory of Christ in those moments. Does that make sense? So what that means is when we rise, we will reflect the glory of Jesus. But I don't know if we'll be transfigured. Yes, I suppose if that's one way you want to word it. But that's a... I'm not sure that's the exact same thing. But something is different. So again, this is my favorite illustration. N.T. Wright, his wonderful book, Surprised by Hope, talks about all of this stuff. And he says in there, we always wonder, will we recognize one another in heaven? Because, you know, they don't recognize Jesus. How will we recognize each other? And he says, it'll probably be something more like this. Like, Keith? Keith? Oh, Keith, you never looked so good. Like, it'll be, you know, like, oh, it is you. My goodness. That's what you're supposed to look like. This is amazing. Like, but it's like a good thing. We just, everything is better. I won't. It was the one-eyed person I looked at, you know. So.
What about previous spouses and things like that?
What is this? This all comes up. The same questions this morning. Previous spouses, like you have a plan for Dave or something. I don't know.
Well, just looking ahead.
Okay, so a couple of things to keep in mind. Wow. I mean, there's more than we have to get into tonight. So maybe we won't get through these verses. These are the same questions that came up this morning.
By the way, they try to trick Jesus.
Yes, tell me the story. What happens there with the Sadducees?
Well, he went through the whole thing about if someone dies and then the brother marries and then they die.
Yep.
I think they asked him, would they all still be married in heaven?
Correct. So the idea is, now the Sadducees, keep this in mind, it's very important. The Sadducees denied the resurrection. They did not believe there was a resurrection of the dead. So they try and trap Jesus in his theology one day. And there's an Old Testament law that says if the oldest brother dies, it's the responsibility of the younger brother to marry his wife to carry on the family name. So the Sadducees take this law and they think they can use this law because they're legalists and loophole theologians, and they think they can use this law to deny the bodily resurrection. And so they come and they say, all right, Jesus, so the older brother dies. So the next brother has to marry the wife, and he dies. And this happens through seven brothers and one very depressed wife. Now what happens at the end? Who is she married to? What's Jesus' answer?
You're not given in marriage.
Yes. In heaven there will be neither marriage nor being given in marriage. And then he says this, you are very wrong. I mean, there's the emphasis, you are quite wrong. In other words, you are questioning the resurrection, you are bonkers. You're just off. But the idea there is that in heaven, everything is made new. And the purpose and the function of marriage is not for the new heavens and the new earth. What are the three biblical reasons for marriage? Now, I've been trying to figure this. This is something I'm working through still in my head. Why does Jesus say there won't be marriage or giving in marriage? Because it's not like marriage is a bad thing. And it's certainly not that it's something like the Catholics would say, like, oh, that's a good thing, but it's not as good as celibacy or something like this. Like, it's part of God's good creation, so much a part of God's creation, it's pre-fall first week stuff. I mean, this is God made woman for man because he created marriage. Like, it's a big deal. So why none of it in heaven? What are the three main purposes? Go ahead.
Procreation.
What's the second one?
Parenting.
Which we'll put with procreation.
Companionship.
It's not good for man to be alone. And there's one other thing. 1 Corinthians stuff here.
Oh, to keep you from sinning.
To keep you in check. That is correct. That's right. And I know that marriage has done that for all of us, right? None of us sin once we're married. At least I keep telling my wife I have never sinned once since married. Not in that way. Never mind. That joke went way off track. The idea is, though, that these things in heaven will be gone. There won't be need for procreation anymore. There won't be need for... And now, mark this. There won't be a need for companionship in that way because all will be one in Christ Jesus. And someone asked this morning, and I think there's actually more here than I let on this morning because I've been thinking about it today. In heaven, the marriage relationship is Christ and the church. So there, perhaps more of what's going on there is this idea that, hey, your perfect companionship is in Christ because he is the main focus of heaven. And this is the main point. And finally, we won't have to worry about keeping our sin in check because sin is down in the fiery removal area. It's not an issue anymore. But this is the main thing that I think we miss in this entire conversation. The whole point is Jesus. What's the point of the resurrection of the dead? To be in the presence of Christ. So that we had one seminary professor, and I don't... Well, he was actually at Fort Wayne, so do with it what you will. But he said this, and at first I was really irritated with it. But I do think there's a point to it. We said, well, we recognize... So he said he would always get this question in class. Will we recognize each other in heaven? And so finally he started answering. He said, I don't know. Maybe while you're sitting in the heavenly choir looking at Jesus and rejoicing in his presence, you'll look over to your right and say, oh, good, they're here. And then you'll go back to looking at Jesus. Because the point of the resurrection is Christ, to be with our Lord. And that's the emphasis here in Revelation. Now, it's not to say that we won't live, and it's not to say we're just going to be singing all the time. At least I hope not. We'll be dining and we'll be feasting and we'll perhaps be working in a way that's glorious and joyful for the sake of everyone around us. But the whole point is Jesus. And I think we get this really right in that wonderful hymn, For All the Saints. And the line that I can never get through, but I think it's just the most wonderful line, where he says, and lo, there breaks a yet more glorious day. The saints triumphant rise in bright array. The King of glory passes on the way. Alleluia, alleluia. That's what we're looking for. The King of glory coming. To see Christ coming for us and to look upon his face once and for all and to see the one who created us and who loved us and who died and rose for us. To no longer trust him in a meal, though that's a wonderful thing, but actually to have him pass the wine. You know, I mean, this is really quite something. So the focus in heaven is Christ. So these other questions, as important as they are just secondary. What will we be like? I don't know. Jesus will be there. Will I recognize my loved ones? I don't know. Jesus will be there. Because he's what we're looking forward to. Does that make sense? Okay.
I'm not sure I can imagine living where there's no sin.
No, you can't.
It would be so foreign.
This is where all of this kind of talk becomes dangerous, because we just don't know.
No.
Yeah. Our description of a sinless life is probably going to be look pretty sinful once we're there. It's just going to look kind of strange. Yeah. I mean, it'll call you the sinless life. Oh, I'm going to try and imagine what that's like. And when we get to heaven, those will be the jokes we tell. Yeah. Like, can you imagine? We were thinking that, right? I mean, it's just...
Can you imagine sinning?
Yeah, it's just going to be something unfathomable, but marvelous. It's marvelous. Yeah. Okay. Good.
We've done one verse,
didn't we? Yeah. No. Yeah, you're right. Okay. We did the same thing this morning. Okay. That's okay. We're still moving faster than they were. And I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne, and the books were opened. Then another book was opened, which is the book of life, and the dead were judged by what was written in the books according to what they had done. Okay. I mean, I don't know how much more you can pack into one verse. So who are the dead here? Great and small.
Everyone.
I think it's everyone. Yes, I think this is correct. And I think that we want to read dead here simply as shorthand for the died and risen. Those who have died and risen again. Because this is the judgment at the resurrection. Because it will say later on, the sea gave up their dead, and the dead are standing. So everyone has been raised. And this is just a quick note, because I don't have the verses written down, but it's worth noting, everyone rises from the dead. The resurrection work of Christ applies to every single human being, righteous and unrighteous.
And then verse 13 closes with, each person was judged according to what he had done.
Yeah, we'll get there. I want to hold off on that verse for just a moment. We're not going to get our way out of it, which we're going to believe that verse. It actually turns out, even as Lutherans. But the idea then is everyone stands before the judgment of God. Everyone. All humanity. Okay? And which is very interesting here, then, I think, what makes the scene somewhat very intimidating is there's no angels, there's no anything but God on the throne right in front of you to judge. That's a terrifying prospect. Okay?
Courtroom without a lawyer.
Yes. And a judge who knows, a judge who saw the tape, right? I mean, that's right. Yeah. Okay. And then we have these books. We've talked about the books, but now this, again, I've been working through Exodus, and I think next time we teach Revelation, we're going to, because it's not going to go fast, we'll do it while we read Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy.
Yeah, because reading Revelation goes too fast.
Exactly, exactly. You're right. So we'll include the Torah and all 87 chapters or whatever it is, and it'll just be perfect.
I can't believe you said that with a straight face.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, I don't.
It'll make more sense.
I don't appreciate sarcasm. I don't. So, but look, there's this amazing verse when Moses comes down on, you know, this amazing section where Moses is up on the mountain getting the law of God, and then Joshua, you know, hears war sounds down in the camp. Well, what's going on? Well, Moses has been gone for a long time, and the people don't know where he is, and so they say, Aaron, what are we going to do? Make for us gods. And so Aaron says, all right, give me all your gold. And the text is, he takes everyone's gold, and he forms and shapes a cow, a golden cow out of the gold, and sets it up and says, this is your God who brought you up out of Egypt. And we all say, well, that's nuts. But all Aaron is doing there is saying, look, I'm just going to show you an image of what God is who brought you out of Egypt, and it's going to look like the Egyptian gods, but it's beside the point. We're just going to worship God through this cow. Still bad news. So Moses comes down and he's furious with the people, and God says, I'm striking them all dead and I'm starting over with you. And Moses intercedes and says, God, you take, you promised you will look bad to Egypt if you kill them now. Wait. Then he goes down and sees what's going on, and he says to Aaron, what is this cow? And Aaron says, they gave me this gold. I threw it in the fire, and out walks this cow. That's what he says. It's just a great line. And Moses is furious. People die. I mean, all this terrible stuff happens. And then Moses goes up on the mountain and says, God, blot my name out of the book of life. I don't know if he says book of life. But he says, blot my name out of the book and save these people. And God says, I will blot out who I will blot out, basically. I'm in charge of that. You go down and continue leading the people, and there's some judgment and all of this. But the idea there is that there's this book that God has there in Moses' imagery, which sort of is listing the people and their sins. And God is keeping track. I know we don't like that Santa Claus imagery of God. I don't like that Santa Claus imagery of God, but here you seem to have a naughty list. Here you have God's record, the book by which records are kept. And it's judgment imagery, right? It's a courtroom scene here. So as much as Lutherans take flack for always emphasizing the courtroom metaphor, that's what you have on the Day of Judgment. Here's the courtroom scene, okay? And here is the ledger with all of the account of your sin.
But there's two books. One of them is the account of sins. The other is the account of people that he resurrected, or that he has some sin.
That he saved, that have died and risen through baptism, have faith in him. Yes, and this is the key. Because at the end of the verse, it says, well, at the end of verse 3 and at the end of verse 13 and at the end of verse 12, it says, everyone will be judged according to what they have done. So is there a judgment based on works at the end?
Yes.
Yes. You can't get out of it. I mean, this verse cannot be changed to say something else. And if you don't have faith in Christ, that's very bad news. Because there's only one book with your name in it. And it's got a record of your life. God knows. It's the book, we might say it this way, it's the book of the law. But then we have another book. The book, we might call it, the book of the gospel. The reformers, the Lutheran reformers, incidentally, in the Formula of Concord say the book of life is just an image of Jesus. That Jesus is the book of life. And it's a metaphorical way of saying you are in Christ. So how is one in Christ? Through faith alone, baptism, the work of Christ in you. Those who are saved, their names are written in the book of life, and they have nothing to fear. So there are two books there, the law book and the gospel book. And the gospel book is the good news for those who have faith in Jesus. Does that make sense?
Well, then they are not judged on their works.
Well, here's where it gets interesting. Because are Christians judged on their works?
In a sense, yes.
How so?
That's their response to their faith in Christ.
Yes. And does God find any sin there?
Oh, sure.
No. No.
In our works?
This is the amazing part. So go to Matthew. Well, we don't have to go there. But Matthew 24, at the judgment of the sheep and the goats, Jesus says to the goats, when I was hungry, you didn't give me a thing to eat. When I was thirsty, you didn't give me anything to drink. And when I was naked, you didn't clothe me. And they said, what? But we were so busy at church. When did we see you doing those things? And Jesus says, whatever you didn't do for the least of these, you didn't do for me. And there's their judgment on works. That's all God saw, apparently. What does he say to the sheep? Two things. First, come to me, you who have been chosen by my Father in heaven. Gospel language. Forgiveness of sins. I died for you. You believed in me. That's election language there. It's gospel stuff. So the ones whom God has saved, you and me. And then, what does Jesus say about their works? When I was hungry, you gave me something to eat. When I was thirsty, you gave me something to drink. And on the list goes. Well, when did we do that? Whatever you did for the least of these, you did for me. And I noticed, and I liked it. You know what he never said? You know what? Jesus does not have a single word of condemnation for them. Not a one. So that even on the day of judgment, Romans 8, there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, even applies to the works of the saints. Does that make sense? I mean, this is really quite something. We don't talk this way a whole lot, but this is what the New Testament is saying, is that your good works, your thanksgiving to God, these are pleasing things to the Lord. Not because you're so great and you're just doing all the right stuff, but even your works are pleasing by grace alone. Because your works are covered in the blood of Christ. Does that make sense?
It's making more sense.
Yeah, and so God does, when he opens the first book and sees you, he's like, well, all right, Joyce, hungry, you fed me. Thirsty, you gave me something to drink. Well, I was busy sinning. I don't find those things. There's blood all over those sections. See, Colossians has the same kind of language where he says, the record that stood opposed to you has been nailed to the cross. Your condemnation is on the cross in Christ.
So even the sin you're committing when you're doing the good deed has been forgiven.
Yes. Yeah, it's not registered against you any longer.
So you managed to do both at once.
So what we would say is, as someone who is both sinful and a saint, simultaneously sinner and a saint, there's no work a sinful human being does that is not corrupted or impacted by sin. There's no such thing as a pure good work coming from us while we're still sinners. It just doesn't happen. Which is both terrifying and freeing at the same time. Terrifying in that it reminds us of just how far gone we really are. And freeing in that, okay, so I don't have to try and be perfect to save myself. Because Christ comes only for sinners.
But when you try and do something and you blow it.
Yeah.
It's still okay.
I hope this is not upsetting to you guys, but I'm going to tell you this anyways, a little insight I received from my call situation. Someone said to me, look, either decision you're making, you're going to be sinning, so just make one. Oh, I said, that was the best line I got the whole time. And I'm not joking, because the entire time I'm just living in terror, like, I'm going to sin with whatever decision I make. I'm going to go one way, and it's going to be sinful. And it's going to be for the wrong reasons. And I, you know, and he's like, oh, yeah. So I stayed here.
It's less trouble.
That's right. Yeah.
Definitely.
Yeah, that's right. But I mean, there's something to this where it says, as a sinner, you're sinning. Sinner's going to sin. But as a saint, God's not holding it against you, because he sees you through the blood of Christ and he's pleased with the decision. Either way. There's a tremendous amount of freedom in that. And it's a different way of thinking Stephanie called me on this too through the call process. She says, whenever you talk to other people about this stuff, you always say, you are free in Christ. And you are living right now like you are not. She didn't say it in such words, but it's really where she was going. And it's true. We do this with our college students, right? Like, I just want to know where God wants me to go to college, so I just want to obey his will. Go to college or don't. Pick which one you want. You're in the will of God because Jesus died for you. So wherever you go, just as long as you're not going for sinful reasons. I mean, that's a never conversation. Well, I want to go where I can party harder. You know, like, well, all right. That might not be the Lord's will. See, but if you're trying to figure out really discerning what the Lord's will is, act and know that you are in the will of God, that his face is smiling on you, that the benediction is still for you in this decision. Does that make sense? There's a freedom in that. So is your sin decision going to be sinful? Is your moves going to be sinful? Your good works going to be sinful in this life? Probably so. And God does not hold them against you, because there's no condemnation for you who are in Christ Jesus.
You can spend an awful lot of time trying to discern God's will and don't do anything.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And so...
do something.
Which is probably sin in and of itself.
That's right. Yeah, you're not trusting the freedom you have. Yeah. You're trying to... yeah. The scariest moment in the whole thing... one more story and then I'll move on. As I was driving to the retirement home, and the call committee chair called me, and I was talking to him on my Bluetooth, and he was just calling to encourage me and be very kind to me, and I said, you know, the thing is, Joel, I've become like this strange enthusiast where I'm looking for God and like the stars and the clouds, and I'm trying to find signs, you know, everywhere. And he goes, well, you know, when I got my calls, I looked within and I had a feeling, and it was always, the feeling was always right, and it always worked. So maybe that's enthusiasm. Like, I don't know, but I'm always looking for a sign, like not inside. I want to see something. And so he kind of laughs, and we get off the phone, and I'm pulling into the retirement home. As I'm pulling into the retirement home, there's a car in front of me with a massive bumper sticker that says, "Keep Austin Weird." And at that point, I just said, I said, that's not a sign, that's a joke. that's God just having fun at my expense, I think. So I'm pretty well convinced that on the day of judgment, you know, I'm going to stand there and he's going to say, well, you were covered in Christ, but when I gave you a sign, you didn't listen to me. so there you go. No. It was the right decision to stay. Just those are the process, that's what happens. Okay, moving on. There you have it. But does that? I think that's an amazing passage where you have the two books, the law book and the gospel book. And for those whose names are written in the book of life, there is salvation. It does not say their names are not written in the other book, as if our works are superfluous or do not matter. They do matter a great deal. How we live now does matter. In fact, this second Peter verse we read was very interesting. It says this: the heavens and the earth are going to be destroyed. And everyone always says, and so what that means is that Christians just don't care about how they live in this world, because the world's going away anyhow. And there are Christians who have used it that way. But you see what Peter said there? Therefore, what kind of lives ought you to live, knowing that this kind of judgment is coming? And then he probably says something about doing good. But strive for what is good and holy and righteous, something along those lines. And so this new heavens and new earth is an impetus to live faithfully now, to persevere against sin, to not let the devil get a foothold. And this is where that Ephesians 6 language becomes very important, where we put on the full armor of God so that while we await the second coming, we stand firm in the faith that we have, and we persevere and we fight, because we know something greater is on its way. So we continue to do good and love and serve as Christ would have us do. Does that make sense? Okay. Good. And the sea gave up the dead who were in it. So the question this morning was, what if at the resurrection someone has been cremated and their ashes have been scattered at sea? Will God still be able to raise them? And the answer is, of course, no. All right. The sea gave up the dead, except the, you know, burned ones. The sea gave up the dead who were in it, and death and Hades gave up the dead who were in them, and they were judged, each one of them, according to what they had done. There it is again. And then, this is just great, death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire. This is the second death, the lake of fire. And what did we say the second death, what that meant was? The end, the final death, like nothing after that. This is the judgment, they're just not coming back. They won't be seen anymore. Death has died once and for all, something like this. And isn't it interesting that death in Hades or death in hell, however you want to name that, are judged and condemned here? 1 Corinthians 15, once again, speaks this kind of language, that the last enemy to be destroyed is death. It's not the devil. It's death. Because the devil was defeated on the cross and at the resurrection through the ministry and the passion of Christ. But here, the last enemy is death itself. Death is not a friend. death is not good news. It is something to oppose. It's something to mourn. So if you ever want my opinion on why we call funerals life celebrations, it's probably not the right thing. It's actually a time not to rejoice, but to weep. And to be allowed to weep. You should weep when someone dies. It's okay. It's the right thing to do. You should be sad, because it is sad. When people die, no, not to look forward to marry someone else. And I don't mean to be snarky with this next comment, but when people die, they are dead. And that's a very sad thing. But we were talking about this morning, is people often think, well, no, they keep on living just in a different way. No. Though they might be aware and in the presence of Christ, they are not alive. They are awaiting resurrection. They are awaiting life. But they are not alive. Dead people are dead. But they're not done. The hope of the Christian is not dying and going to heaven. It's dying and going to heaven and coming back again. Someone said it. This is how I've been trying to remember this phrase all week, and I just finally got it. One of our professors said, heaven is great, but it's not the end of the world. Pretty good line. And so I think that's the way to think about it, that the hope is life. So we weep over death. However, that being said, Luther has, and I think there's a proper context for this kind of language too, Luther says, like in the New Testament, death is often described as a blessed sleep for the Christian. That it's an enemy because it's against God's design for things, and yet for those who are in Christ Jesus, we're going to bed and we're going to wake up. We're going to rise again. And now he's not talking about soul sleep or you're unconscious in heaven or something like that. I mean, that's I think, beyond the pale of that comment there. The comment there is simply, we're laying your body down and your body's going to get back up, only renewed and refreshed and better, resurrected. Does that make sense? Okay. Okay. I think that's kind of what we want to go with there.
You read so much now, and I don't remember even a few years ago, the obituaries and everything. They said, well, you know, they're smiling down from heaven.
Sure.
They're always walking with you and all that.
They've earned their wings.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's another one that occurs. Yeah.
And please, I mean, if you've said this one...
You know, they're with you all the time.
And if you said this one, you know, I understand your heart was in the right place, but please don't say to somebody, especially after a tragic loss, oh, heaven just wanted another angel.
Yeah.
Please, heavens, please don't say that, because then heaven is just a wicked place. But, okay, all right, so. Because, I mean, we say those things, and when we say those things, our hearts are in the right place, we're meaning well, but we're misunderstanding things, and we're not allowing people to grieve. If there's any place to grieve, it's a funeral. That's the right place to grieve. Okay. So, because we're getting rid of death and Hades. Now, Rob Phillips brought this up. I don't know how far I want to run with this, but I do think it's an interesting concept. It says death and Hades, and there was some understanding in Judaism that Hades was the holding place of the damned dead, as opposed to the blessed dead, that's they're not fully damned because they're not resurrected and suffering in hell, but they're awaiting their final judgment. There is no more of that place either. There's no waiting room. If you remember the a parable of Lazarus and, oh, what do they call him? Lazarus and the rich man. And the rich man dies, and Lazarus dies at the same time, and Lazarus is taken up into Abraham's bosom, like Abraham walks with him, and the rich man is on the other side of the fiery lake, and he's calling out for water, and he's giving orders, you know, okay, Abraham, have that man put water on my tongue. And Abraham's like, I don't think you quite recognize how the tables have turned right now. He's not giving you anything. And now, I don't know how far we want to run, because it's a parable, and we don't want that to be an exact picture of life, of what the souls of the dead are doing, but the imagery there is perhaps that person is in waiting in Hades, something like this. Okay, so go ahead.
Well, verse 13 says it right there. Death and Hades gave up the dead who were in them.
Yeah, so there it is, right. Yeah, so I think that makes a lot of sense then. Yeah, yeah, death and Hades kind of working together. Yeah, very good. And again, in anyone whose name was not written in the book of life, he was thrown into the lake of fire. And so there is the judgment of the unrighteous, those who have not trusted Christ. Not the unrighteous who are merely doing naughty things, but the unrighteous who are doing naughty things apart from faith in Jesus.
Would you say that those in the Book of Life are the baptized ones?
Mm-hmm. And I would say, I'd go so far as to say it this way, baptism is the writing of your name in the Book of Life. Now I know before time began and eternal questions become all very complicated with that, but I mean, the point of that is saying, how do I know my name's written in there? Well, you're baptized, aren't you? So whether he wrote it in then or before, because he was going to baptize you, he baptized you, so you're in. You are in Christ. In the Book of Life is just another way of saying in Christ, for those who have faith in Jesus, who are saved by grace alone. Make sense?
So is baptism, writing your name in the book, something that God alone does?
Yes, correct.
So how do Baptists justify delaying baptism?
They do not see baptism the same way we do. They do not believe baptism saves. They would say baptism is merely a symbol. Well, they wouldn't use the word merely. I will. They would say baptism is a symbol, an outward act of an interchange, I think is the language they use. They may correct me on that. But in your heart, you have been saved, and baptism is your way of saying, God, I'm committing myself to you. I gave my heart to Jesus, and now to prove it, I will be baptized so that, as a confession before the world. So for the Baptist, baptism is a confession of faith. Say, I believe this, and to show it, I'm going to be baptized.
So we would do that at confirmation.
Exactly right. Which is why I read this thing the other day where another Fort Wayne prof, that's two in one night, so let it be known that I've quoted two in one night. But he has this argument where he says Lutheran confirmation is the most pleasing practice to any church body, because it acknowledges that baptism saves, and so the Catholics will like that, and the Orthodox will like that. It's an opportunity for someone to stand up in front of the church and to say, this faith is my own, and the Baptists will like that, because now someone is actually making a public declaration of their faith. The Presbyterians will like it, and I forget his reasoning why there. But there's all these, like, you're claiming to be a part of the church and all this. It's just everything that every denomination is trying to pick and choose from, and it's all kind of concentrated right there. It's a wonderful practice in that way. But for us to say, confirmation is saying, I'm confirming in my heart, with my mouth, that I believe in my heart what happened to me when I was baptized, that God did save me. And I am confessing that I believe that I was saved by grace alone through Christ alone. So for the bottom line is this. For the Baptist, baptism is a work that I do. For the Lutheran, baptism is a work God does to me.
Do the Baptists have sacraments?
No, they call them ordinances. Yeah, if they call them sacraments, they mean something different. The Lord's Supper is a meal of remembrance. It's not a gift.
And it's not so even biblical remembrance.
What do you mean by that?
Well, if you go back to the Deuteronomy passage.
Sure, yeah.
At no time does God come to them and speak to them?
Well, this is where, now here, when you say the Baptists, you are dealing with such a large umbrella of things. The free will Baptists, for example, it'll all be an Arminian sort of, we work towards God. It's all we decide to be saved, all that. Then you have Calvinistic Baptists who are going to say things like, God does all the saving, but baptism is not. Baptism is to be delayed because it's a confession of faith and not a work God does for us. So the Baptist will say, the Reformed Baptist, and those are the Baptists that I would prefer to deal with just simply because I think they're the better ones, if you can say it that way. The Reformed Baptists are going to say, nope, saved by grace alone, and that salvation was given to me before the foundation of the world in God's preordaining things in his sovereignty, and it came to me when I heard the word. So they're gonna put a big emphasis on the preaching of the word and the teaching of the word. But even there, a Calvinistic Baptist will not be able to say something like I do on Sunday, where I say, I forgive you your sins, or your sins are forgiven, and point to you that this is for you. Why? Because I'm not sure if you're elect. You will know because of the inner spirit telling you. and you'll see it in the good fruits of your life. You know, like you will see it change. You weren't, I once was lost, but now I'm found. I once was, you know, having 3 beers a night, and now I'm having 2. But now, there's a difference between, well, never mind, I lost the joke. Anyways, forget it. The joke is funny, and I can't think of it now. But anyways, the Baptist is going to use a lot of good language about grace alone, faith alone, Christ alone, good Reformation language, and then you say, how do you know it's for you? And they will immediately go to the inner testimony of the Spirit and the fruits of the fruits of the Spirit. Because I see these changes in my life. Which for the Lutheran is just utter despair. Because we take the law a little more seriously still. And we say, yeah, but Jesus isn't telling you to improve. He's telling you to do it perfectly. Or to die. So he can raise you. See? So there's a whole theology that's at work here. Where the Lutheran is going to... The Reformed Baptist is going to locate salvation in the past on the cross and up in heaven in the mind of God. And the Lutheran is going to locate salvation in the past on the cross and delivered to you now in the sacraments and in the Word. So it's down to earth. Where is salvation for me? Down here for me. In baptism. In the Lord's Supper. And they're going to say, well, you can't just baptize babies and expect God to save them. What if they don't believe? What if they don't confess? Don't they have to? And see, that's where you're already in trouble. Don't they have to? And this is where baptism becomes just... The Lutheran teaching on baptism... Scratch that. The biblical teaching of baptism becomes utterly offensive because it forces the grace question to a point that we're just not comfortable with. So there you go. Does that answer your question or too much?
Me?
That, yeah? Yeah. Yeah, the place to go with your Baptist friends who want to know why you Lutherans think baptism saves is to 1 Peter 3, where Peter says, baptism now saves you. And just let the verse stand. And they'll say, well, the next line is, but not by washing with the water and the word, not by mere washing, but through the resurrection of Christ. And you say, yes, yes. Water baptism now saves you through the resurrection of Christ. It's not because you took a bath, it's because Jesus made a promise. And as soon as they try and get away from some sort of saving baptism in the water, just read the whole verse because Peter says we're saved through water like in baptism. And they'll say, oh, but they never baptize babies in the Bible. You never see them once baptizing a baby in the Bible. And you know what I say?
They save the whole household.
Yeah, that's right. The other thing they don't ever say is that they let women to the communion table. Shall we start preventing women from coming to communion? No, of course not. In other words, it's a bad argument. It's a bad argument. It never says also, it also doesn't say, don't baptize babies. So now we're both coming from an argument of silence. So why not just read what the texts say and trust them?
And John concludes his gospel with, there's many more miracles to talk about, but you've got enough here to come to faith in Christ.
That's right. Yeah, that's right.
So some things were left out.
Yes. Yeah, sure. Yeah, that's right. Does that all make sense? There you go. How do we get to that? Oh, the Book of Life thing. Yeah. And that's the offensive part, because they're going to say Book of Life up in heaven in eternity. And we're going to say Book of Life down here in water. There you go. Okay, guys. Next week, Revelation 21-ish. Let's sing the doxology and go home. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him all creatures here below. Praise Him above ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Thanks for listening to this Bible study presentation from Faith Lutheran Church in Moore Park, California. We hope this has helped you grow in your Christian faith and study of the Bible. For more information, visit us on the web at faithmoorpark.com.
Music by Kevin MacLeod.